Welcome back into the nest for more intimate chats with the lovebirds. Now, with more discussion about love, sex, and relationships, here are Drs. Chuck and Joanne Bird.
Welcome back to Intimate Chats with the Lovebirds, and we were talking with Dr. Shannon South, who is our special guest, and we're talking about wisdom, love wisdom, and relationships, and all that good stuff. So, Dr. Shannon South, are you still with us?
I sure am.
And I loved it because you were talking about the inner qualities that enhance passion and love, and you were talking about mutual respect, safety, support, freedom, all these wonderful things, and humility. And I also like what you talk about, being in the moment, and we love this, fun, humor, and spontaneity. I think we're all about
that.
Fun, humor, and spontaneity.
That.
Yes, most definitely. I tell you, that brings such a wonderful enjoyment of each other to the table. And
absolutely,
it's just beautiful to be able to enjoy each other. And, you know, again, when you feel supported and you feel the freedom to be exactly how you need to be, as well as that kind of support, it makes for a beautiful combination of that spontaneity and creativity just to kind of blossom. And I think about like a flower. It naturally blossoms in the sunshine. And we're like that as beings. If we have the right environment, we just naturally blossom.
Absolutely.
It's a beautiful thing.
Absolutely. We agree with you on that. That's for sure. How do you see intimacy as a sacred practice?
Intimacy is a sacred practice. Say that again?
How do you see intimacy as a sacred practice? In other words, into me, you see.
Exactly. Into me, you see. I love that. It is definitely a vulnerable practice. In the sense of, if people can get past their defense mechanisms, and their more unconscious ways of being in the world, then they can really get down to this present moment awareness of what's happening with themselves at the moment. And that's a practice in itself. That takes consciousness to do that. That takes paying attention.
Yes.
If we're not paying attention to our moment, we're missing a bunch.
Exactly. Exactly. And you also talk about transpersonal psychology. I love that. And so what is that? What is transpersonal psychology?
Yes, transpersonal means beyond the mind. So it's about accessing states of being that are beyond all that mind chatter that we have all day long, chatty, 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 chatty.
Okay.
And the transpersonal piece also allows, the processes that I do with clients, they allow folks to reach their more unconscious parts that they're not so aware of, as well as the superconscious parts of themselves that are the more joyful, free, wonderful qualities that we, you know, all love to feel like and be like.
How do they access that, the transpersonal psychology? I know I do it for individual therapy, hypnotherapy. Is that what you're talking about?
Wonderful. Yes, that's one way to access a transpersonal state of sorts. Because the process that I use actually accesses it through symbols. So we use belief systems. We find out what the person's belief system is around the certain pattern that they're wanting to change. And then we do emotions as well, the emotion around it, because we say the emotions are kind of like gas to the car. They kind of propel forward the process. And then we use symbolic sight. So the unconscious will speak to them in symbols. And it's so funny. They come in my office and they're like, oh my gosh, I'm not going to get a symbol. What are you talking about? And they always get a symbol that represents the pattern.
Wow. And
great.
It's a symbol that they, in other words, they're open to. You start talking about that you're going to envision a symbol, or is it something in their dream that it comes to them?
It could be a dream symbol they've had before. Carl Jung, you know, the Swiss psychiatrist, he would probably say it comes from the collective unconscious.
Right.
That symbols are like archetypal symbols that we all can relate to, like a heart. We all know what a heart is. You know, a heart makes us kind of like, aw, you know, or whatever.
Right.
Those kind of symbology, the symbols come and they represent a certain pattern. And then what the transpersonal process will do is it brings a symbol for the new pattern. So it's kind of like growing up old patterns. Like these patterns, you know, are acting one way, but they're really old and they're not working. Like you said, they're in the past. And our present moment wants a new pattern. It wants a new, like a new tires, or we're talking the car theory again. It wants something new to run with. So the subconscious, superconscious will bring down a new pattern with a new symbol, and it will integrate the old symbol into something new energetically that allows the person to lead with a different pattern in their life. So it's really exciting.
Now, do you actually work with both people doing that when you're working with them in a couple? Because I'm trying to figure, how does that increase the intimacy between the two?
Yes, we can do that. It's interesting. There's several couples I've seen that are really, really close, and they will get the same symbols when I do process work with them. And to me, that just tells me the level of closeness that they have, because they're accessing things in their unconscious that are so similar. And so sometimes in the process, I will do a process with their partner there, but I usually focus on the individual. And then the way it translates into their relationship would be that they're able to come to that person with a more conscious, integrated self. Does that make sense?
Yes, it does.
Yes, very much so.
Wow.
So
yeah.
Yeah. So we're talking with Dr. Shannon South, if you're just tuning in. How would that maybe even relate to our interconnectedness to the all? And how does that play a role in our intimacy?
Yes, the more support we feel to the world in general, the more connected we feel, the more relaxed we are, the more spontaneous we are, the more excited we are, the more we feel like little kids. And so our intimacy would flourish when we're feeling connected to the all, because, you know, with depression and anxiety, and feel extremely disconnected to the world and to other people because they have so much loudness going on inside of them, so much going on. Mm-hmm. And when that's kind of dumped out through these different practices and cleared out, and we fill ourselves back up with that kind of loving, intelligent, creative wisdom, boy, the intimacy just flourishes.
And it makes sense because you have all that energy freed up again to devote to each other, being in the moment.
Clearing that window again.
Exactly.
We clear out our closets. We need to clear out our inside.
That's true. So you're almost like one of those professional, decluttering, the people you can hire.
The organizers.
Help them declutter.
Exactly.
You're decluttering their life.
Exactly. Their minds and all that good stuff.
Exactly.
That's fantastic. And so you have that, you do that with them, and I think, actually, as we're sitting here talking with Dr. South, yes. I'm looking at each other, and I'm like, we must be really interconnected to the all, because we are very playful and connected and supported.
And have that humor.
Yeah, and very much live in the here and now, so.
Yes.
Fantastic.
Yes.
Great qualities to have.
Yeah, we love it.
You guys, when I met you.
Yeah, exactly. Oh, when we didn't say this, but we, in the beginning, when we were trying to get you on, Dr. South, we were saying, we met you. We were trying to explain to the audience that we met you on the Hay House cruise, and how Hay House is this wonderful publishing company online, and they have all these spiritual self-improvement type books. Mm-hmm. And we were on this cruise, and that's how we met you.
Yes. And I remember we were actually on the beach, and I saw you guys walking down there, and y'all were just so playful and happy and talking. And it was beautiful.
It was fantastic.
Yeah, and deep. It's good to be able to be in the truth and go deep, because, if we can be in our truth, it's just a beautiful thing to see.
Exactly. And in your book, you also discuss, and I can't wait to hear about the upcoming book, too, but in your current book, you discuss the three pillars of love. And I just even love that. Pillars of love. What are they?
Yes, we have the love to the other person, which is, the one that I think a lot of people go for first, when they're younger. They're like, oh, I need a partner. And that's great, but it doesn't do it all. And then we need the love for ourselves. We need enough love for ourselves to pick a healthy enough partner, right?
Right.
To complement that. And then the love for our soul, or our kind of higher, wiser intelligence, developing a relationship with something that's loving and guiding and supportive inside of us and around us. And so those three types of relationships really create a wonderful triangle, like a grand trine of sorts, of three different love relationships. Mm-hmm. And when those three are in a really good balanced place, our relationships flourish. They just thrive.
And again, I'm so visual as you're talking about that. I'm seeing it as a stool that has the three legs.
Yes.
And if one of those is not sturdy and strong.
I was actually thinking that myself.
You talk about a symbol. When that is not sturdy and strong, if there's one that's a little bit weak, so to speak.
Sure.
The whole thing is off balance.
That is exactly it. Because if one of the relationships is unhealthy or toxic, there's been trauma or it's been damaged in some way, it'll, create an imbalance in the whole system. And then often, the focus turns on the person that's in front of you and you're the relationship with you, or it turns, towards self-sabotaging behaviors towards yourself.
Right.
And so it affects everybody.
Yeah, and I can see that.
Definitely.
I can definitely see that. And I love that. I love the three pillars of love. And all this stuff is in your book, right? Love Wisdom?
Yes.
Exactly. Yes. So we're going to talk about how people that are listening can get that book and where they can find it so they can actually get more information. But you also mention four stages of relationships. What are they?
Oh, it's very exciting to see people because the first stage, you know, when people first meet, is like the codependent stage.
Yes.
They're so excited. They can't hardly stand it, and they can't stay away from each other and all those great things.
Yes.
And in that stage, people are really working on bonding and trust. Mm-hmm. You know, they need to bond, and they need to learn that they can trust this wonderful person in front of them. And when that stage gets complete, they can kind of move away from the person a little and go into more of a counter-dependent stage. Okay, I can live without you, but I still want you, you know?
Mm-hmm.
Sure.
And so the counter-dependent stage, which is a stage of reclaiming your own self a little more again, mm-hmm. but also wanting that person there, kind of a separation process. And then the next stage is the independent stage. And in the independent stage, you're practicing being in your own energy and then fusing into the other person's energy and going back and forth and back and forth in the independent stage. And the third stage is more the interdependent stage, which is when the couple becomes a source of inspiration to the world, which is probably what you guys are.
Yeah, we're more independent. We used to, without knowing the term, we used to call it a healthy enmeshment. But it's more interdependent.
That's beautiful. So yeah, it doesn't suck the life out of you, kind of a mess, right?
Exactly. Exactly.
Very good. Yeah. Very good.
And,
so yeah, there's four, and you see people go back and forth between those stages. You know, it's not like we 1, 2, 3, 4, we're done. Sometimes, you know, something will happen, we'll have to go back to the trust and bonding, or something will happen, and we'll have to go back to tweak, you know, one of the developmental places in those stages.
Exactly. Exactly.
All right. Well, we have to
go to break.
Go to break.
Okay.
And Dr. South, can you stay with us for the final segment?
That would be wonderful. I'm enjoying this a lot. Thanks.
Well, thank you.
Okay.
And we'll be right back.
We'll be right back after these messages.
Lovebirds will be right back with more intimate chats about love, sex, and relationships after these messages.